Well, hello. It is such a joy and an honor to be here with you today. And I have anticipated this day for months, as I know that you have. I want to thank Dr. Stewart for inviting me to be here. And most importantly, I want to thank TWU for insisting that I wear this robe, because I didn't have to shop for a dress or worry about what to wear. It just came down to shoes, and I changed shoes 7 times before I drove over here. You have done something wonderful for yourselves. Today, you create a legacy for you and your family. Your parents and supporters can brag all about you, and you, yes, you guys, can brag on yourself. Most importantly, your children can check the box that their mom or dad is a college graduate. You have now become, yes, a bigger role model for them, and they, because of you, will seek a higher education. In short, guys, you have just changed the world. And change is why I've been asked to be here today. I want to tell you about my life and the unexpected and ever-changing opportunities that come everyone's way. Hence the title of the speech, Everything Is Perfect. I changed. I graduated from Southern Methodist University with a degree in film and journalism. And I chose it because my mom thought I would look really good on TV. My first job was at Channel 5 in Dallas, and I arrived on my first day around 7:30, and by lunch, wondered what I had done. I knew of every crime in the city, phoned the county morgue several times a day for updates, and drove home that evening to add another lock to my door. I didn't last long in the business. I changed. I grew up as an only child of entrepreneurial parents. And as a kid, I lived in a very imaginative world. I had all kinds of animal friends that existed in my mind, and some of them are here. After college, I was young, my cost of living was low, the news career was definitely over, and I had no commitments to anyone. I decided to follow my heart and my imagination. I began my toy company in 1983 with 6 bear samples. Now, I want to tell you, I didn't really like bears. I really preferred rabbits and cats. But at the time, bears were the most popular gift item that stores wanted to buy. I hired sales rep groups all over the nation to sell my products. And what this means is that I loaded my bear samples into a huge duffel bag, walked into the Dallas Market Center, up and down every aisle, showing my samples to every sales group that would look at them until I found the perfect group that was the perfect match to sell my products. Several months passed, and after they were pleased with my sales, I asked them to recommend me to other sales groups at all the leading markets, such as Los Angeles, Chicago, Atlanta, and New York. I was around 21 years old, and my business was born. My big break came in early 1984. When the buyer for Neiman Marcus called. The Republican National Convention was coming to Dallas, and she wanted to know if I had elephants. Well, I excitedly replied, "Of course I do." Well, I lied. I didn't. I had only 6 bear samples in my line. So I stayed up all night. With fearless thinking, I lopped the heads off all the bears, sold elephant heads on them, and was in her office the next morning with elephant samples. I had my other samples with me, and she bought the whole line, and the relationship and business never stopped growing. I set up my production locally around the Fair Park area of Dallas. The 80s were all about growth and creativity. The 90s brought increasing pressure to take my production to China. My suppliers were closing in the US and moving overseas. Retailers were demanding cheaper products, and my profits were dwindling with every single shipment. I have a very high standard for how my product is made and a very involved management style. You know, I had been present for every product we ever produced, and so had most of my employees who had been with me from the very beginning. So how do you do this? It was a difficult time, both emotionally and financially. I made certain my employees had other jobs. And you know what? I changed. At the end of 2000, I began production overseas. It was going to be perfect. The move allowed me to bring costs down and increase production. Not being involved in the day-to-day allowed my creativity to flow like never before. I was able to compete like I had never competed in my life. The buyer for Victoria's Secret was shopping at a boutique in New York and found my product. She called to see if I could produce for them. And of course, I could. Game on. Our first ever shipment from China was produced for Neiman Marcus and boutiques, and it got on the water. That means a very large quantity of finished toys just got on a very large ship, and it's headed to Dallas. My first product for Victoria's Secret was still in production, and 9/11 happened. If all my orders didn't cancel, they got cut in half. Victoria's Secret cut their order from 40,000 pieces to 20,000 pieces. No kidding, for the next 3 weeks after 9/11, every time the phone rang, my hand shook. And you know what? I changed. Retail at the time was so beaten down by the fears brought by 9/11 that for the following 2 years, everything would have to be very easy to sell. My wildly creative production turned to animals and colors that were limited to only the best sellers. It was time to play safe. That meant that everything had to be pink or white, and only a bear, a rabbit, or a cat. And then, around 2005, everything came back. All the buyers wanted more creative products again. So once again, hey, game on. And then, of course, think back a year or two, 08, 09. The US economy tanked. We're still recovering. Retail dwindled. And then a new toy regulation was enacted in response to the poor quality and mass quantity oversights by some really big toy companies. This new law raises the testing price for each product, and in some cases, doubles or triples the cost. For some small companies, it can cost 1 year of total revenue just to meet the requirements of this law. The law is for any product, marketed to a child aged 12 and under, and for any product made anywhere, not just China, not just India. This means even here in your garage. It has frozen many small and mid-sized companies, leaving the companies that caused the problems in the first place as some of the only companies that can afford to stay in business. Financially, it caused me to temporarily halt my business.